lecture, we're going to be talking about business cycle theory. The syllabus includes looking at what mainstream and real business cycle theories predict, the different types of inflation, negative effects that deflation can have, and describing the relationship between unemployment and inflation using the Phillips curve. Let's start off by explaining the mainstream and real business cycle theories. There are multiple mainstream business cycle theories, but all of them emphasize that potential GDP, or long-run aggregate supply, grows at a stable rate, but aggregate demand grows at a fluctuating rate. Let's say, for example, that due to sticky wages, AD moves to AD2. It grows at a faster rate than long-run aggregate supply. Thus, short-run macroeconomic equilibrium is at the point at which AD2 and SRAS1 intersect. An inflationary gap opens up. If AD increases at a slower rate than potential GDP, for example to AD3, then a recessionary gap opens up. However, if AD grows in sync with long-run aggregate supply, then we would maintain long-run macroeconomic equilibrium, and AD would shift to AD1. Keynesian cycle theory is one of the mainstream business cycle theories. It states that fluctuations in investment are driven by fluctuations in business confidence. When a business's confidence in its future prospects increases, it can undertake more investment, and vice versa. It is investment that causes aggregate demand to fluctuate according to Keynesian cycle theory. Monetarist cycle theory, another mainstream business cycle theory, predicts that fluctuations in investment and consumption, which are driven by fluctuations in the growth rate of the quantity of money, are the main source of fluctuations in aggregate demand. The faster the growth rate of money, the more consumption and investment take place, and the quicker aggregate demand increases. The slower the growth rate of money, the slower the growth in consumption and investment, and thus, the slower the increase in aggregate demand. Classical theory emphasizes the influence of unexpected changes in aggregate demand. For any given expected price level, if aggregate demand decreases, people will not be expecting a decrease in the price level. Thus, as the expected price level remains the same, real GDP decreases. In the same way, if aggregate demand suddenly increases, the price level is assumed to remain the same in the short run, causing a temporary increase in real GDP. The new Keynesian cycle theory, another mainstream business cycle theory, argues that today's wages were negotiated in the past, which means that past rational expectations of the current price level influence the money wage rate, and thus the position of the short-run aggregate supply curve. New Keynesian theorists believe that both unexpected and currently expected fluctuations in aggregate demand bring fluctuations in real GDP and potential GDP. Real business cycle theorists see random fluctuations in productivity as the cause of economic fluctuations. The driving force is said to be technological change. However, other factors such as international disturbances, climate change, and natural disasters also impact the business cycle. As I mentioned, the driving force of the growth rate of productivity, according to the real business cycle theory, is said to be technological change. These new technologies are discovered when companies invest in research and development. However, the rate of technological change is not constant, and so the rate of productivity growth is not constant. This is what causes the business cycle. A period of rapid productivity growth brings a business cycle expansion, and a period of slow productivity growth causes a recession. In the long run, all technological change brings increases in productivity, but sometimes existing capital, for example human capital, can be made obsolete in the short run. People might lose their jobs because they have been replaced by machines. This could cause a temporary fall in production, as these people now do not have jobs, and thus there are few people working in the economy as a whole. Let's say that a certain technology has been discovered, which has made existing capital completely obsolete. If this occurs, productivity is temporarily reduced. Firms would expect profits to fall, and would thus undertake less investment expenditure. This would cause the demand for loanable funds curve to shift to the left, signifying a decrease. An expected decrease in profits would also bring about a decrease in the demand for labor, as firms fire workers. According to the real business cycle theory, people decide whether or not they want to work by performing a cost-benefit analysis. they compare the return from working now to the expected return from working later. Workers work less when the real wage rate is low, and work more when it is high. In addition, the lower the real interest rate, the less interest a person will get on their income. Thus, they would work less in the present and work more once interest rates increase. These two factors combined reduce the labor supply as well. The graph above is a continuation from the graph on the previous slide. It shows what happens following a decrease in the demand for labor. It is worth noting that the demand for labor shifts further to the left than does the supply for labor. So the real wage rate is still less than it initially was. There are arguments to be made in support of and against the real business cycle theory. RBC supports the idea that the money wage rate is not sticky. This is simply not true. Workers will not agree to a wage reductions, but will agree to wage increases. RBC also claims that the labor market experiences intertemporal substitution for labor. In other words, people will work at a later time if they expect a higher wage rate in the future and will not work in the present. It is argued that this substitution effect is too weak to account for large fluctuations in the market. Economists argue that if it is indeed fluctuations in aggregate demand that causes the business cycle, then it should be explained using theories that affect aggregate demand rather than the labor market. Finally, some economists view productivity fluctuations as a consequence of the business cycle rather than a causal factor. The real business cycle does have some merits despite its criticisms. The theory is able to explain macroeconomic factors about the business cycle, and all its claims are consistent with known facts about economic growth. It is a single theory which is able to explain economic growth and the business cycle at the same time. Lastly, the theory is consistent with known microeconomic decisions about labor supply, labor demand, and investment demand decisions.